All right. Well, we have today Lane Carter, Joe Hyde, Todd Kolls, and Tommy Usery. Usery. Did I say it right? Okay, Usery. Thanks. So, opening statements. We're going to start first with number one, which is Lane Carter. 2 minutes. Kristen will let you know your timeline, and the rest of you are welcome to sit if you'd like until it's your turn.
I want to thank everybody for coming today, and especially one person that is to blame for this forum, Judge Floyd. I thank you for your service the past few years, and presiding judge. I'm Lane Carter. I'm from here in San Angelo, born and raised 34 years. I was a graduate of Central High School, a graduate of ASU twice, a bachelor's in biology and a bachelor's in nursing. I served as a nurse 6 years before I was elected to the San Angelo City Council. And now I'm a general contractor, builder, remodeler here in San Angelo. I ran for city council in 2016 by walking the streets, and for one reason, to serve. I have two children now. I did not at the time, but we were expecting one at the moment. So I want to make this community the best place to live as possible. I grew up here. I want them to grow up here. I do not want them to move away. I did not move away as myself. I'm running for Tom Green County Judge to hopefully make a bigger impact and to serve our community. Items I'm running on, I think we all are, economic development, because that's the one way to stay above the inflationary rate, maintain our tax rate or decrease it over time, hopefully. We have two interstates coming through this area. Now's the time to prepare for the future. We have to prepare for that now and look ahead to see what we need, what this community, how we're going to be impacted. On council, we ran for water, streets and drainage, civil service and economic development. We made tremendous strides during that time, and I am looking forward to serving as your next Tom Green County judge to make the same type of strides as possible. Thank you.
My name is Joe Hyde, and I'm running for county judge because I think you guys want three things. You want a competent county government. You want a county government that doesn't infringe on your personal civil liberties. And you want a county government that can keep a lid on crime and provide the infrastructure to do that. I also think, I've covered the news for a long time, and people say, don't mention San Angelo Live. But that's my proudest accomplishment. I mean, to start something from nothing. And because of that, I've covered the news a lot. I've covered all three governments. And I've seen them work for the last 9 years. I got the big picture. One of the things I've seen more recently, there is not one elected official except one who's ever said that you deserve a tax rate decrease. That was Mayor Gunter. She said that this last budget session. And she was rolled over by all the other people on the council. And they would not allow her to do it. I'm running on one thing, I think for part of your personal liberties is the fact that you need to keep more money in your pocket. And this is really a whole lot symbolic because the county government is just a cherry on top of the big cupcake that you pay in property taxes. But if you can elect one guy, or maybe I can start a trend where we start electing people who say, we are going to lower your tax rate every year. Every year we're going to lower your tax rate. And if you look at the economic conditions that are coming up right now, we got sales tax through the roof. We have a county that was run well by Judge Floyd and his staff. We have all the ingredients right now where that's an easy gamble for me. I'm an entrepreneur like you guys are. This is an entrepreneurial pledge to you that I'm going to lower the tax rate every year. That way you have a seat at the table when this judge is negotiating with all the other officials. That's one of the main reasons I'm running. Anyway, I'm Joe Hyde, running for county judge. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon. Whoa. Good afternoon. I am Todd Kolls. I'm asking for your vote in the upcoming 2022 Republican primary for Tom Green County Judge. I was raised in San Angelo, graduated from Central High School in 1998. My wife and I met in our church youth group. We got married in 2005, and we have three beautiful children that are 14, 11, and 8. I own a jewelry store downtown San Angelo in the bottom floor of the Cactus Hotel. I started that jewelry store in 2011 with virtually nothing. I didn't have jewelry cases. I didn't have a desk. I didn't have a computer. I didn't have a phone. And I was talking to my dad one day, and he said, "Well, Todd, what's that in your pocket?" I said, "It's a cell phone." He said, "Well, there you go." So I started on the, I started this business. I was able to find a $50 desk at Christians in Action. I was able to find two jewelry cases that my dad found for $50 a piece. I'll never forget, I had my kids or the family laptop, you know, and about 10 years ago, laptops, you turned them on and they lasted about 10 minutes till you had to turn it off and turn it back on, and you had about 10 minutes worth of, till it froze up again. And I had a cell phone. And the Chamber of Commerce came to do my ribbon cutting, and I didn't have any jewelry in my cases. So my wife and my mom let me borrow all of their jewelry to put in my cases so that it looked like a jewelry store. My mom said, "You better not sell any of my jewelry." I said, "Well, it depends on what I get for it." I was raised by two loving parents. My dad was a home builder here in town. He raised us, me and my brother, on construction sites. I understand working on construction sites. We built many homes together. We built his commercial storage rooms as well together as a family. And I understand the needs and wants, and home builders have a special place in our heart and in my family's heart as well. And I wish my dad could have been here today, but he's not. So thank you, and ask for your vote.
Good afternoon. I'm Tommy Usery. Now we know who to blame for two forums in one day. Judge Floyd, thank you. And thank you to your staff. And thank you for your remarkable service over these many years. You've done a remarkable job. Thank you. My wife, Patricia. Patricia is here with me this afternoon. We're married. We have two adult children and two grandsons. We're very proud of those boys. And we, if we're not thinking about politics or work, then it's the boys are involved in it. I'm from San Angelo. I grew up here. I grew up in Lakeview. In fact, Judge Floyd and I went to junior high and high school together. We've known each other since we were just teenagers. I won't say how many years that is, but we've known each other a long time. And I'm very proud to be able to call him a friend of mine over these many years. At Lakeview, for my high school period, I have an ASU Bachelor of Science degree. Before I actually obtained that, I was on the San Angelo Police Department for about 10 years as a police officer. Worked patrol division. I worked as a detective in narcotics and did undercover work for a few years as well. And I finished up my time with the police department on the back of a motorcycle. That's the most dangerous part of the job that I had. After about 10 years, I left to go to the Texas Department of Public Safety as a DPS trooper in the Highway Patrol. I was stationed originally in the Houston area by the department, and I ultimately got to transfer back out to West Texas, where I went from a population of about 6 million people to 1,500 people in the county. We're glad to be back in San Angelo now. After I left DPS, the 20 years in law enforcement, I went to law school, back in Houston again, and I have been practicing law for 26 years. So we also ask for your vote.
Thank you, gentlemen. Just wanted all of y'all to know on this forum, we've got, if we have time, five questions. We will not be taking questions from the audience. The candidates are going to stay if you'd like to visit with them after the forum. And also to let you know, they do not know what questions we're going to ask. So, but as a point of reference, we have printed on little note cards the questions. So this is question one that Lana's handing out. Some of them are really wordy, so we wanted them to have a point of reference. So first question, gentlemen. The county judge of Tom Green County wears multiple hats throughout a given day. County administrator, lead budget officer, presiding officer to the commissioner's court, judicial duties, presiding over probate, guardianships, and drug courts, emergency management, multiple civic boards, and media requests, just to name just a very, very few. Tell us why you feel you are prepared to step into the role of County Judge of Tom Green County. Mr. Carter?
I believe I'm prepared to step into this role because I have served in the past 6 years almost on the City Council, serving on boards. I was the Mayor Pro Tem in 2017. I was the most recent chairman of the executive committee at the Concho Valley Council of Governments, serving with numerous county judges of this area. During their time on council, we were hit with a couple emergency management situations, such as a tornado in 2019, the freeze last year. And during that time, it gave us all of experience on the council of dealing with those issues. During that tornado, Michael Looney and I, proud to say he's one of my friends, and we were out with our chainsaws. We were clearing roads. We were clearing driveways. That way, citizens and road crews can come in and take care of their business in the Bradford area. It was devastated. During the freeze, everybody was out of water. We were just hit with the contamination in Paul Ann. So our water systems were down. Then the freeze happened. The entire city went down. Our high plains were hit. Our low plains were hit. We were out trying to deliver water. We were out trying to get the dialysis centers water. That way they did not have to triage their patients. We stayed on top of that. And I'm proud to say that I was able to stay on that with the managers. That way they did not lose any patients due to not having water. That is some critical thinking that you have to stay on top of. You have to be in connection with your elected officials in all various areas, Charles Perry, Darby, Pfluger. You need to know how to communicate. I've done that for the past 5.5 years. I'm proud to say that I have. It has been a wonderful experience, and I look to use that experience in the next few terms. Thank you.
The next 4 to 8 years are going to be hell for us. And it's not because of anything we've done here in Tom Green County, but it's because of the national politics. That's one of the main reasons that kind of motivated me to jump out of my role as, you know, the publisher of San Angelo Live to run for judge, because I thought we're going to go through hell the next 4 years, probably next 8 years. We're going to have rampant inflation. We're going to have a government, the federal government, that may or may not have our best interest and our health in mind, things like that. I've been a combat pilot for most of my life. For 20 years I served. I've been in combat, I've been shot at, I've had to fly through flak and not turn back, because if I did, someone behind me was gonna have to fly through that same flak the next day. That doesn't scare me. I'm the only one here that has the nerve to say no to a lot of things, a lot of crazy things that we're gonna be asked to do. You know, vaccine mandates and all that kind of stuff, I mean, that's the thing of the past now, but what's coming next? Who knows? Who knows? Finally, I'll just say on the taxes, saying I'm going to lower your tax rate sounds like a small promise, but is actually a big deal. And it takes someone with the nerve and the courage to be able to do that and follow through with what I'm saying I'm going to do. But you guys need a seat at the table. That's the biggest thing. Finally, I think the Judge Floyd's, I've interviewed him a million times. I've watched him in action. I've learned from watching Judge Floyd. I think Judge Floyd is an excellent speaker. He's spoken with authority. He has earned his authority. I will do the same thing for you. I'll run the county with an incredible amount of integrity and competence. Thank you.
Why do I feel that I am prepared to step into the role of County Judge for Tom Green County? Well, let's go through these. County Administrator. I am an administrator on a daily basis. I own a business. I have people that work for me, and I have to make sure that they're all getting along and they're all doing what they're supposed to be doing. As well, at the same time, I have to administrate my customers out front. I have to get customers in the door so that I can give my employees something to do on a daily basis. So I am constantly being an administrator. A lead budget officer, well, I own a business. Not to mention, I was also president of COSA DC for 2 years, vice president for the 2 years previous to that, and on the board for the past 6 years. We had an $8 million a year annual budget. What that is it takes half-cent sales dollars from taxpayers and puts it back into our economy. COSA DC then decides what we're going to do with that money every year to turn it back into economic development for your community. Presiding officer of the Commissioners Court. For 2 years, I presided over the COSA DC Board of Directors, running those meetings on a monthly basis. Presiding over probate, guardianships, drug courts, emergency management. We're all going to have a learning curve here, okay? None of us have been on Commissioner's Court, and none of us have been a county judge before. All four of us are going to have a learning curve. We're going to have to learn what to do in emergency management. The way I would handle emergency management is one word, communication. You have to have everybody communicating at the same time with each other, with the county, with the operations director, and with the finance people within the county so that we have the funds we need to act in an emergency situation. I have served on numerous boards around town, YMCA, Better Business Bureau. I give back to my community. This would not change at all, serving on numerous boards and doing other things that the county judge has to do right now. Thank you.
As an attorney for the past 26 years, part of my law practice has been government and administrative law. So I've practiced in this field for 26 years now. As Mr. Kolls suggested, he's the administrator of his business. He is the head budget officer. Those things apply to me as well. I have my own law firm, and the buck stops at my desk. In addition to the experience I think Mr. Carter was talking about his emergency management experience, I've been a frontline emergency first responder for 20 years and been called on many times as a first responder to respond to major disasters, including hurricanes down on the coast, including flooding in the Houston area. None of us have all the experience that we need. We're going to have to learn, and Judge Floyd has a tremendous staff there that is set and ready to go to help us. The person who has the least amount of time required to get up to speed is me. When I say that, I can walk in on day one having practiced government and administrative law and other types of law. I can go in on day one and begin hearing the cases that the judge is required to hear. I've participated in our system here with Judge Floyd as the judge, where I'm advocating on behalf of a client appointed by the court, and I'm very familiar with all of these particular areas of law. The other candidates for this job can get up to speed. It may take them months or maybe a year or so to get up to speed. I'm ready day one. With respect to the administrative part of it, we're all going to have some lead time, but at least I have 26 years of legal experience in administrative and government law.
Question number two, and you will start first, Mr. Hyde. By now, you have all had ample opportunity to research the county's finances, review reports online, and visit with key finance officials. What, if anything, do you see as a financial threat or an opportunity to the county? And tell us if you would want to discard or keep those opportunities or threats.
The biggest threat to the county, finances. First of all, let's talk about the good things. The good things is we have cash in the accounts of the county. The really good news is we have sales tax that's rising very rapidly. Sales tax revenue. The bad news is, and also one more thing, our property valuations. You guys are getting rich because y'all made good choices in how you invested in your land. And the aggregate value of the land in the county has gone from $6 billion to $7.5 billion in about 3 or 4 years. So that's awesome stuff. That's the good news. The bad news, and where the pressure is going to come for the next county judge, is in December, the consumer price index for Tom Green County went up 9%. And last month, it went up about 7.15%. So we have county employees who we're going to have to get raises to just to be able to buy food at Sam's, you know. So that's going to be balancing that. And with how much money we got coming in from you guys, the taxpayers, because y'all made great investments on your land. One of the things I hear a lot here is economic development can grow us out of this. Economic development, everything they're talking about are long-term plans. Long-term plans. There's no magic unicorn or pixie dust that we can sprinkle on this and say the judge, who has no budget really for economic development, can do anything about. But the two things we can do about economic development as a judge is make sure Goodfellow Air Force Base stays open. And number two is, right now we can't broadcast this thing live because we don't have broadband internet. I've been trying to talk about broadband internet for the last three forums and no one wants to talk about it. But broadband internet is the economic driver that a county judge has a lot to say in this county. That's all I want to say. Broadband internet. Thank you.
I can vouch for the fact that Joe has talked about broadband internet. Okay. What, if anything, do you see as financial threats? Well, I'm speaking to the right crowd. It's called inflation. How much was a 4x8 OSB? How much? $28. What was it 3 years ago?
$9,
$11. Okay. Y'all know inflation. Y'all know what that does, right? Well, guess what? Everything the county does, everything the county tries to invest in, everything the county's going to try to build and go and do, they're paying the same inflation. Okay? That comes out of your pockets. That's your tax dollars that we're also having to pay inflation on. That is an enormous threat. Now, what can we do about that? It's called economic development. We have to bring the tax base up. Midland County, if they raise their taxes 1 cent per $100 assessed evaluation, they gather about $25 million of revenue. Tom Green County raises that same 1 cent of assessed value per $100. You know what we raise? 7.5. Okay, right now, Tom Green County, the homeowners are paying 65% of revenues that come in are coming from homeowners. Business owners are getting 35%. Okay, it's the exact opposite in Midland County, Taylor County too. Economic development, let those businesses pay that tax. Let them have more of that. Economic development is something that this community desperately needs, and we're set up in a unique way, in a unique position out here to do so. The airport is an enormous one, okay? You fly into DFW, how long are you going to wait on that tarmac if you have issues with a plane or issues with weather? Okay? How long do you wait out here at San Angelo? We have enormous opportunities with the railport. That's another deal. Economic development is going to help save that inflation and help bring that tax base up. Thank you.
I would agree with the consensus up here, it's inflation. We have issues out at the detention center primarily associated with the inability to retain staff or to get proper and qualified staff hired in. The sheriff is hamstrung to some extent. He is required to abide by the Texas Commission of Jail Standards, and he can only put so many people in that jail according to how many. According to how many staff members he has on his staff. So that's an issue, which means a pay raise. We're talking about pay raise for at least some county employees. Inflation will continue to drive the value of our dollars down. And as Mr. Kolls suggested, that means economic development. That cannot occur overnight. We're blessed with having a wonderful Chamber of Commerce who is working diligently, I can tell you, on economic development plans. But there's no quick fix. So we have to plan for these matters over a period of time. And we need to grow the county in a smart way, not just have someone move to our county with a business that doesn't provide a living wage, that doesn't provide for benefits such as medical care, so that those people do not wind up on the county rolls as an indigent patient and that we're paying the cost of their health care. And also to work with the San Angelo Development Corporation as well. Those are our opportunities. We are going to have tremendous growth. That's a positive thing, but we need to be prepared so our resources are in place to take care of it.
I think going forth on this question, I'm just going to beat the drum one more time. Threats and opportunities. The county budget has two fluidities, main fluidities. One you have control over to have an aid in as the county judge, one you do not. On the revenue side, economic development. On the expenditure side, capital murders. You do not know how many capital murders you might have during that year, and that takes a major toll on your expenditures. But on economic development, with partnerships through the community, whether it be Goodfellow, ASU, other businesses, the Chamber, the Development Corporation, and the cities and towns around us, we can accomplish so much if we combine forces in a lot of areas. That way we are not doing the same actions, but independently. I'm a big fan of grants, federal grants, matching grants. If we can bring outside funding into this area, we've seen it with the ARPA funds coming in, $11 million so far, 11 to come. You have to allocate those by the end of 2024, spend it by 2026. There's seven criteria. One of them is broadband internet infrastructure. If anybody was impacted by the COVID relief, essential workers, using those funds wisely and knowing how to divide those up to each individual sector is going to be crucial. So Mr. Kolls brought up one good item, and that's our airport. We have a regional airport, but it does not take very much to get the international airport designation. You just need some officers, TSA officers, to check planes. You don't have to be DFW coming in from international areas. And that can be a major factor to this area. When you have time, go look at the airport tropolis idea. It's crucial. Thank you.
Question number three, Mr. Kolls, you will go first. Are you in favor of giving tax abatements to corporations to incentivize economic development? How much is too much of an abatement before it is no longer beneficial in reducing the tax burden on homeowners?
I am in favor of abatements. COSA DC, City of San Angelo Development Corporation, what we did, and I'm going to use this as an example, but Ethicon came to us. And Ethicon wanted some help building some new buildings. They wanted some new equipment. They wanted this, they wanted that. And I don't remember the exact numbers, but for the sake of argument, let's say it was about $200,000 that they came after the COSA DC board to try to get them to help. I was president of the board at the time, and my first comment was, why are we helping Johnson & Johnson with $200,000? That's when I had a learning curve. That's when I learned that there was a town in South Dakota, I believe, where another Johnson & Johnson complex was built. That city was willing to give them that. Okay, so now we're dealing with it in a little bit different terms. Okay, we don't want them moving. We don't want them leaving. If it's fair or not fair, that's not for us to say. But what we had to end up doing was, yeah, we're going to help you. What else do you need? Because that other community was willing to do it, we had to be willing to do it as well. That works for Goodfellow. We help Goodfellow with a lot of things. Why? We have to have Goodfellow here. We have to, y'all. We cannot let them close that down and move on. So why are we helping the federal government build apartments or build infrastructure out at Goodfellow? We have to. How much is too much of an abatement before it is no longer beneficial to... I don't know. But COSA DC staff is an excellent source to use to be able to say, this is what we're going to get from the benefit of doing this, and this is what we're not going to get, and this is the medium area that we need to try to land in. So we have to use those professionals we have working for us right now. Thank you.
I'm in favor of abatements for the right corporations. What's the right corporations? I mentioned it in my last answer. One that brings something to the table for San Angelo so that they're not a drain on San Angelo ultimately, but they're providing good living wages for our citizens. Of course, we have to work in conjunction with the Chamber of Commerce and the Development Corporation, the San Angelo Development Corporation. How much is too much? Every deal has to be different. What are they bringing? What sort of economic development are they bringing to the table? How many employees are they going to have? Are they going to be a long-term good citizen? Are we growing our county and our economy in a smart and progressive way? So every situation has to be different, and a determination on a case-by-case basis must be made, and that is made in conjunction with the Chamber, with the Development Corporation, and county officials, the county judge and the commissioner's court as to whether or not this makes sense for a particular corporation. But in general terms, I am not opposed to abatements. They can bring, over long term, they can bring more than we give. And that's why the trade-off makes sense.
I'm in favor of abatements when necessary. We have an outstanding staff at the Economic Development and the Chamber that has the ability to sell our area without having to come to the City Council or the Chamber to get those abatements. I've only seen a couple of them while we were on the City Council. And their efforts to approach these companies and sell this region is outstanding. Outstanding. The odds, when the odds outweigh the financial and economic benefit, that's when you start plugging in their yields and you start seeing what that company can bring to this region. And when it starts looking to where it's not beneficial for that abatement and not so much of an impact, then it might not. You need to go through some negotiations. You have to, you know, work with that company. If it comes down to make or break, if they're going to go to Abilene, which we've seen in the past, or Midland, Odessa, if it's worth us doing a few abatements for them to get them here in this region, then I think it would be definitely beneficial.
My goodness, I thought they were all Republicans. We're talking about crony capitalism, and it's on a small basis when we're starting to give money to people who are favored, to people who are the insiders. And we've seen it time and time again from COSA DC. Now, there's some things that COSA DC's done well, but I'll remind you that there was Medtronics, a company called Medtronics. COSA DC gave them a whole bunch of your tax dollars. There was the Martifer Hirschfield windmill thing, right? Y'all remember that? That was all those things end in failure. But what COSA DC does well is fund things like that pipeline from Hickory Aquifer. And the reason why that's a good investment is because it benefits all of us. It doesn't benefit the special few. Another thing that was good for the half-cent sales tax, I believe it was founded to fund the Spur Arena. So think about how much enjoyment all of you have gotten out of the Spur Arena. I think that these half-cent sales tax should be used for large infrastructure projects like dredging the Concho River, that benefits all Americans and all San Angelans and all Tom Green Countyans, right? All this stuff has nothing to do with the county judge, though. But broadband internet, y'all laugh at me. Don't listen. I'm gonna be serious about broadband internet. The governor has about $100 million worth of money he's gonna dump on all these counties in Texas to build out broadband internet infrastructure. This is the chance that the next county judge is gonna either be fair and have integrity with how he does it and do it among a mission, or he's going to dole that money out to all his cronies and buddies like we've seen done in the past. So one more thing, if we got rid of tiers, I don't know if y'all familiar with tiers, right? Everyone here. The county could have about another $500,000 a year. That'd be about a 3/4 cent tax deduction if we got rid of tiers. So I'm not for that. I'm just letting you know how much this stuff costs and where it's going. Thank you.
Fourth question. Mr. Usery, you will go first. It has been many times It has been said many times that success as the county judge involves more than just performing the job duties, but it also includes having a servant's heart. What does that mean to you?
A servant's heart. I describe it and think of it as a commitment to service of our community in one fashion or another. And we all do it in some ways, or you're doing it here today, for example, by attending this forum and trying to decide who you believe should be our next county judge. And I'm doing the same thing by being here standing in the line of fire. And that's what I've done most of my life, is stand in the line of fire for someone, for our community. 20 years in law enforcement, first line, first responder, bumps, bruises, cuts, shootings, deceased people, accident, serving the community in a way that makes some sense, serving the community in a way that makes a difference, serving the community in a way that provides safety. 20 years of doing that. Another 26 years as an attorney providing a commitment to service of our community by representing individuals. In some instances, I'm paid to do that by the client. They have a legal dispute with someone else for some reason, and we process that through the court system. And guess what? There is no shooting or stabbing or fist fight because we've handled it in a civil way. By providing services at greatly reduced attorney's fees to the county as appointed counsel for individuals to help process that case through the court system. And today, agreeing to commit the rest of my career to commitment of service as your county judge. The county judge position is very important. It provides a lot of leadership. In fact, probably the most important leadership role in the county, and I commit to you to do that. So that's what a servant's heart means to me, is providing services to your community to make it a better place.
I think a servant's heart is to step out of your personal realm and put your life and your family's life on the line, to step out there and take action, not sit back and watch, to make this place a better place to live and have better outcomes. It's listening. It's listening to your constituents whenever they call you at 8 o'clock at night and you're on the phone for an hour and a half. It might be, in my case, it might be bedtime for my kids. It might be dinner time. You're gonna have to know how to respond to those and have a background behind you and a support system like my wife and my family. And I thank them for this for the last 5.5 years. You'll have to learn how to listen to people and their problems and then go out and try to fix it. You might go out late at night at 9 o'clock if someone is having a water issue, or a flooding issue. Stepping out of the time that you might be going and getting ready for bed for yourself or during lunchtime. Servant's heart is stepping out and making that difference where others might sit back and watch. You're out there putting your life on the line and your time on the line to better serve this community and to better serve the constituents in it. Thank you.
I can sit up here and talk about being in the military and how, because I served your country, our country in the military, I have a servant's heart. I'm gonna take a little twist on it. And Tommy will understand this because he's been in combat arms also as a law enforcement officer. But the servant's heart, when you're in combat, is to take care of your buddy. You know, when you're in the Air Force, you never leave your wingman behind. I've been out there in a million police chases or police situations where a police officer gets hurt. The first thing that happens, every police officer is in the area, swarms back to that location to take care of their buddy. That's part of what being a servant is also, running into where the danger is to protect the guys who are fighting with you. In the county government, what I'm saying is, I'll go fight for you, man. I'll go fight for you. That's my promise. And you guys can be my buddies. And I'll keep you guys as much as I can. I'll keep you safe. And I will lower your tax rate. I promise that. and I will get you really good broadband internet. And also, everything I do for you will be done with the utmost integrity and fairness, no matter how much money you make or how little money you make. I'll be a judge for everyone. I ran the news thing, San Angelo Live. I was a voice for the little guy. I was a voice for the churches when they were getting destroyed by popular opinion. I went to bat for them at great risk to me, and I survived. If I can do that, if I can get through all this combat stuff, I can do a good job for you. Thank you.
I was raised in a very nice home on Oak Mountain. My parents worked very hard. They came from virtually nothing, both of them. And they came through and they were very successful. And me and my brother can vouch for this. We were raised in a nice home. And I'll never forget, I was probably about 8 years old, and my parents said, "Todd, this weekend we have a project." I said, "Okay, what's that?" And they said, "It's called Christmas in April." I don't know if many of you remember that. It's now referred to as Helping Hands. We went over here to the Blackshear neighborhood right off of 19th Street. It's the house directly behind that Town and Country. On Saturday morning, about 6 a.m., and there was a 92-year-old man that had lived in that house, I think, his entire life. He had newspapers for the floor. He didn't have a roof that didn't leak about every 2 feet. He didn't have running water. He didn't have, I'll never forget that house. My parents brought me up to give back. This is what Christians do, and this is what we do in this house. And you're going to get up and you're going to go. Every year, my dad was a crew member, crew leader on Christmas in April, and every year we did another house. And I can still probably drive to every single one of them. Whenever I got older and I started my own business, one of the first boards I was asked to be a part of was Helping Hands. And that's because of my dad's connection with Christmas in April still. I was a board member of Helping Hands. I was a crew leader of Helping Hands. We did 4 or 5 houses together with Helping Hands. My brother is still on the board of Helping Hands. We give back because that's what we're made to do, and that's what our parents brought us up to know and understand. We're fortunate, some are not. You have a servant's heart because that's what Christ asked us to do, and that's what we do. Thank you.
We have time for one more, so question number 5. Question number 5. Mr. Carter, you will go first on this. Tell us, what do you see as the top priority for Tom Green County?
Development. Development's the only way that we will stay on top and thrive as a community, or else we fail. If we do not stay on top of that, we will be like another community that 30, 40 years from now, when the interstates will come through, and yes, I-14 is first designated through here, I-27 for Ports to Plains. It may get its designation later, but we already know that we are a big intersection for that. Now is the time to prepare for that. We need to stay on top of the economy. We need to get the businesses in. We have to stay with our development corporation to bring them in and sell this area without the interstates to show what we have here. So top priority is development. Sheriff's departments and the jailers, we have horrible retention rates. It's because of pay. But also that goes along with what our tax base brings in. Our budget is only sufficient on what we have as our tax base. So developing that to where we can give more of them to keep the public safe and to retain them here in this area, it will be a blessing. So that is going to be one of my top priorities.
Is this closing remarks too? Oh, I said so in the card. The card said closing remarks, just let you know. Oh, is that the next one? All right. Well, you gave me the wrong card. I want more time.
It's just on there. You'll get that.
Let's go back to development. I started a small business. Like probably 80% of this room has started a small business. How much government help did you need to start your small business? How much government help did you want? You want government to stay out of your way. You want government, if you have to go get permits at the city permits office, you want the permits office to be run competently. If you have to work with the county to get something replat, you want to be treated like a professional. You want your answers answered. You want people to communicate with you. You want things to be done in an efficient manner that doesn't impact your bottom line. That's what I'll do for you. I started a business. I've started five businesses, actually. But the last one I started with practically nothing. I grew this thing into 10 employees. I just lost one, so I'm down to 9. So don't get me on fact-checking. But I grew up to 10 employees. I got a payroll of about $400,000. I got 10 guys who are buying cars at car dealerships, who are paying rent. And by the way, the little guy, like I have a guy back here on the camera, he's probably paying about $1,300 a month in rent. And you know this tax rate problem, when I keep talking about it, who does it hurt the most? Is there a homestead exemption on rental property? Heck no. When someone builds a motel next to your apartment building and that appraised value goes up $3 million, there's no cap. And that affects guys like that camera guy back there. And he can't afford to live here. And that affects things like Goodfellow Air Force Base. So we got to keep an eye on that. That's that's my priority for the county. And the other thing is, I'm not going to go in there and make a whole lot of changes. I as an Air Force pilot, I remember transfer aircraft control to Stanley, a student. You give him the airplane totally trimmed up, and what does he do? He starts changing the power setting, moving the stick, and he's all over the sky, and you have to take the jet back from him and fix it. Well, Floyd ain't going to come back out of retirement to fix it, so I'm not going to mess with too many controls. Anyway, thank you.
What about broadband?
Floyd, you better keep your phone handy, though. Top priority. Okay, I see bankers. I see land developers. I see budget blinds. I see all kind of people in this room. What is top priority day one? Or are you trying to build a property or develop a property or build a house? What's priority after a month or a month after that and a month after that? Priorities change is my point. Day one, my priority is going to be to meet every one of these county employees. I'm going to get in the car with Nate, hopefully, and we're going to drive around and we're going to go to every single county department and we're going to get to know every single county employee. That's my first week on the job. I want to shake hands, I want to talk to them, and I want to visit with them. What do you need? And I'm probably going to have to say, well, I'm sorry, I can't do that this first year. We got to cut taxes. But I want to get to know every single one of them. And then year two, I'm going to have a different priority. Year three, I'm going to have a different priority. But you've got to stay fluid in this job, and you've got to understand that things are going to come at you. We don't know what kind of emergency management needs we're going to need this first year, year two, year three. We don't know what's coming from Austin. We don't know what's coming from Washington. So our priorities have got to change. But right off the get-go, my priority is going to be get with Nate, get with Sandy, get with Diana, get with Craddock, and I am going to get to know everyone in this county. And I'm going to have a personal relationship with every single employee as soon as I can get it done. Thank you.
Top priority for the first week of Tom Green County Judge is to find out what the priorities of all the department heads are, the elected officials and the department heads, and that sets your top priority from there. But generally, I can tell you there are some challenges that the county is facing. One, we've just discussed a little bit tonight, was the Sheriff's Department's retention and qualifications to acquire qualified jailers. That's one. We have a burgeoning mental health crisis in Tom Green County. By that, I mean we have a system that is overloaded. It's working at capacity or near capacity most every day. We want to work with them. We want to work with law enforcement. We want to work with everyone, including our private partners, the hospitals themselves, and other charities, to find the best solutions for this situation that's caused by a multitude of reasons. Drug abuse, substance abuse, homelessness, mental health issues are all related to one another. And it creates a big problem for our county. So we want to discuss with the commissioners and the department heads their approach to helping solve these challenges. We have to get our courts back open. That's a challenge to justice in this community. We've been closed for 2 years. No fault of any of our judges, but the Supreme Court has shut our courts down. We need to push back against that and get these courts open so that our justice can be served here properly. There are at least a few people who have been in the Tonbridge County Jail for over 900 days waiting for trial. That's not justice for that individual. It's not justice to you, and it's not justice to anyone. Our courts have to get open. Getting the courts open will help the sheriff's department with the population that he has in his jail and with our issues with the number of jailers that we have. Thank you.
All right, gentlemen, thank you. Closing remarks, Usery, you will start 2 minutes. Tell us whatever you want us to know.
Well, thank you all for being here this afternoon. I know this is a very important forum, not because I'm involved in it, but because you need to pick your next county judge. It's important to hear the philosophy, the reasoning, the way the individuals who are sitting up here think. And I think we're all relatively intelligent men. We can all do this job ultimately. We're all gonna have learning curve. The learning curve for me is lessened simply because I have a legal background and 26 years experience in administrative and government law. I've been preaching that over and over. And the reason that is important in this election cycle, and particularly for this job, normally, at least in our experience in Tom Green County, the county judge has come through the ranks of the county commissioners. And by the time the judge is seated in the seat, he already has several years of experience on the commissioner's court. That gives a tremendous advantage to an individual having served on that court for years to see how it operates, to see how it functions, who the people are, who the players are, who are the troublemakers. And I'm not talking about citizens, I'm talking about in the departments, and to get those things sorted out. None of us are gonna have the advantage that Judge Floyd had coming in, where he served on the commissioner's court for a period of time and just moved right over into the next chair and served without interruption as the county judge. I provide the best opportunity for us to be up to speed quickly. All the judicial functions that the judge handles, I'm already there. And I think having practiced government and admin law for 26 years, I also have an advantage on the administrative side as well. I ask for your vote, your support, and I appreciate your attention listening to four of us drone on about things for the sixth or seventh time now. Thank you.
Like Thomas said, thank y'all for putting this on and thank you for being here. This, I believe, is the most well-attended forum that we've had so far, so it's nice to get in front of the voters. I am asking for your vote in the upcoming election. I am asking for that vote because I have experience with economic development. I have experience taking tax dollars, tax revenues in, turning those revenues around, and putting them back to work for our community. That's why I'm here. I have experience running meetings. I have experience running a board meeting, using those tax revenues and turning them around for your benefit. The more that we can help, the more that we can do, the more that we help this community, okay, the more the county can do to help, the more it helps you develop land, build houses. The more it helps you have to deal with, I've got inflation costs I can't get control of. Well, thank God the county's going to be able to help with this or that. That is why we're here. I am a calm, business-minded leader. That is how I approach things. I take a problem, and I don't start with the people. I start with the problem, and I work back. And eventually, you're going to get in front of the people you should be in front of to help solve the problem. But you have to get a clear understanding of the problem first. And that is how I do things. I know how to treat people. I know how to be respectful to people. And I know how to keep a level head so that we can go to the problem and we can work our way out of it. And that's why I'm asking for your vote. Thank you.
I know Tommy talks about being an attorney and how he has an advantage over all of us hooligans who don't have a law degree. But of the 254 counties in Texas, only 40 have an attorney who is a county judge. They have to all send all of us to county judge school, and we have to graduate with honors, I guess, to take care of you guys. So every one of us has to go to the same school. That's all I want to say about that. As far as the closing remarks, there's a lot of, you know, they say, well, Joe, you're too mean. You're not, I don't know, Trump used to say presidential. You know, I was talking with, before I wouldn't even run for this position 4.5 months ago. I was talking to one of the guys on my staff, and he said, if people knew how you run our company, they'd make you the county judge. They'd vote for you. If you go look at my LinkedIn profile, and I know that LinkedIn is kind of swishy, but I've worked all over the country. And you look at the recommendations on there about how I've solved very difficult problems for very big corporations. It's there. The record's there. I fear that you're going to say, because I have been successful in the news business, reporting the news, and sometimes reporting uncomfortable things, that I'm a divider. And that's the furthest thing from the truth. Everything I've done is with a lot of fairness, integrity, and I've never carried an agenda at all. But I look forward for you voting for me. Even if you have to keep your Lane Carter signs in your yard, you can still vote for me. And also, if you want some more about me, you can go to joehydereport.com. There's a newsletter you can subscribe to. Even if you're supporting someone else, please do, because I put it all out there. And you can read about what I'm all about. That's joehydereport.com. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks for that plug. I'd like to thank everybody once again for this opportunity. This race has been outstanding. We have our last forum tonight at the stables at Fort Concho, so I invite everybody that is able to come for the chamber, please do so. Lane Carter again, running for Tom Green County Judge. I'm running on integrity. I'm running on a servant's heart. I've had that for the last 5.5 years. The last 5.5 years has prepared me for that 60% admin position of this judgeship. I look forward to that. I will go in with strides to make the difference. I will work for you as the best of my ability. I will not promise, I will not overpromise, but I will take a problem and I will facilitate that solution as I have on the council level. Now's the time to prepare for the future. Like I've said before, I've said it multiple times. I believe I'm the best candidate for this position because of the proven track record. You can look at that. I'm out for the citizens. And I ask for your vote because of that. This is gonna be a crucial race because you're looking at four candidates that have not gone through the ranks of Commissioner's Court. But what y'all need to do, this is in y'all's hands, you need to look to see who is the best qualified. Not the most popular, but best qualified. I believe I am that candidate because of that proven track record, and I will continue to have that integrity for you, for the people. Thank you.
That concludes our forum. We want to thank you for coming. And as you can see, after listening to the four candidates, what importance there is for this leadership position as county judge. The county judge even is over the mayor. So we want to thank Judge Floyd for all his service and his years and his leadership that he's provided for all of us. It's important to vote. Early voting starts February 14th, Valentine's Day. And it will end on February the 25th with the primary on Tuesday, March the 1st. It is important that you all go vote. Your vote counts, so please go vote.